river wide enough, baby.
If you need me, call me. No matter where you are, no matter how far.
Don't worry, baby.
Just call my name. I'll be there in a hurry. You don't have to worry. Cause baby, there ain't no mountain high enough. Ain't no valley low.
Rick Hale, Rick Hale, Rick Hale, Mojo Monday, my friend. How are you?
Man, it's another beautiful day. Let's go Mojo Monday style. Come on.
Mojo Monday style. I'm always happy to be here with you. Got my coffee ready to go, and we're here. So, man, it's kind of sad. This is one of our wrap-up sessions here. We've been doing six personal perspectives for 6 weeks now, and this is week number six. But before I even pop up the graphic, what is six personal perspectives? How has it transformed your life? How has it been a part of your success? Any rational thought around that?
Yeah, I mean, when you lump them together, man, it's a holistic mindset for evolving into the best you could be and eliminating the things that might hold you back and keep you from that best version.
You know, I learned early on in my career, I think in like 2007, I went to some mastermind function with Gary Keller. I was a new team leader at the time. And he said, listen, this is how top performers think. And I thought, man, I don't necessarily think exactly that way yet. Mm-hmm. But I knew that I needed to if I wanted to find big success in my life, Rick. So I made a commitment every 8 weeks for like 8 years in my market center. I taught this six personal perspectives. Because I knew if I would teach them, I would ultimately adopt them into my thinking. And it was just a one little thing that I did that caused me to adopt these into my life. So maybe somebody listening to our thing, our Mojo Monday this morning, might hear that message. And if this is something that you really want to adopt, go teach it. Ask a leader in your organization, do a blog like we're doing, or what do they call these vlogs? Video
podcast.
Vlog? Yeah, podcast, whatever podcast. It is, right? There's your challenge for the day, huh? All right. So, Rick, here's the six personal perspectives. Let's all together here. We've got commit to self-mastery. You know, this one's such a powerful one. It's the difference between, you know, your New Year's resolution and your desire to want to go become the best at something, but also knowing you're probably going to create some opportunity for discrepancy in how to go after that mastery if you don't figure out how to make it work for you, right? And figure out how to master yourself first so you can go after mastering some kind of skill set or task. And then 80-20 principle, in your words, Rick?
It just means focusing on the big rocks first, because if you knock those down, the rest of the world, you know, 80% of what we have on our list, agenda, potential, is it's not irrelevant, but it's far less relevant than the top 20%.
There you go. And you know, it's defined so many different ways as the Pareto principle, like 20% do 80% of the business. But the point of the thinking and the six personal perspective, you said it perfectly, it's understanding what to focus on and how to prioritize that focus to go get the best results possible, right? And moving from E to P, I always joke it was a quirky saying for the longest time until you really understood it. You know, that entrepreneurial self, I like to describe that as my God-given basket of talents, if you will, that I bring to the table, only takes me so far. And then ultimately, in order for me to have breakthrough success, or anyone to have breakthrough success, you got to get purposeful, right? And then last week, Rick, we did make learning base part of your foundation. And two weeks ago we did that. I just love that one because it's about that self-actualization pursuit, which I defined as that subscription in your mind, that there's always a better version of you can become with no destination, right? And then, you know, you told some cool stories last week around limiting beliefs and removing those from your mind and that unlimited thinking and finding the people in your life, and your grandmother showed up But just give me a quick summary. What does that mean for us? Remove those limiting beliefs.
It's just creating a different story in your mind. And you talked about, you know, the storybook where, you know, you have an experience, the experience impacts you, you shape, you go and seek out evidence of that being valid. And then that becomes your story and it's a cycle. And so the whole idea is to unwind that and get back to the reality that, you know, today is today. Are you running an old story, a current story, or are you fighting for the better version of you in a new story? And by removing those, that effectively is illustrating how you're fighting for a new you and a better you.
Love it.
And so,
love
it. Yeah. And what you focus on expands. How can you craft the energy behind the things that are keeping you from the best version of yourself?
Yeah. And really, it's just a good reminder that these are mindsets. These are thinking and how we position our mind to go attack a big goal or to go accomplish something great or to go change lives, right? And yep. It takes us to number six, which is the nasty word, Rick, accountability, right? How to be accountable is a thinking, and it's a willingness to be accountable, right? And we're going to dive into it as the sixth personal perspective today, my friend. So yes, how do you define be accountable? Here's the graphic. And it doesn't necessarily define it outside of give a perspective around the difference between being a victim or being accountable. And what's a victim and what's an accountable person, Rick, in your eyes?
I mean, the simple answer is a victim is somebody that deflects and defers responsibility for the things that happen to them. An accountability-based person is someone who seeks reality and wants to own their experience and own the outcomes, even when they're not good. And instead of deflecting and deferring to something external, they own that that's just part of who they are, and not just because they're defined by it, because it's the journey instead for who they're becoming.
Yeah. Being accountable is really hard to do sometimes. And
it is. Life's distracting.
But it's what moves life forward. And, you know, there's a saying that, well, maybe we shouldn't talk about that saying, but stuff happens. And, you know, we don't get to choose what shows up in our life sometimes. It just shows up, right?
Yeah.
And the purpose of this this mindset is the choice we get to make is how we respond to it, not the fact that it happened, but how we respond to it. What were you going to say?
Well, that's exactly right. And one of my favorite books of all time was Viktor Frankl's book, Man's Search for Meaning.
Right.
And he was in a concentration camp, you know, in the war. And the one thing he figured out is that the only thing you can control is your attitude and your energy around the circumstance. You can't control circumstances. And once you kind of, to some degree, you know, eliminate the energy of negative forces and circumstances and instead just react with positive energy, learn the lesson and move forward, the closer you'll become to mastery of the six perspectives and becoming that level up person you want to be.
Yeah. So I think in our industry, and we're in real estate, you know, an appraisal could come in low. A buyer could lose their job. All the stuff that could show up inside of a transaction that we don't really have control over at all, right? I mean, we have some control, or we perceive to have some control, but things happen. And how about a pandemic? We didn't really have control over that pandemic. It happened, right? So stuff happens in our journey of life, and our choice in how we respond to it is really what empowers or disempowers us in the future. I've got a fun, crazy example. And I hope I don't offend you, Rick, because I know you're a bicycle rider and you ride bicycles and enjoy it. But I think most people were aware of the Lance Armstrong story, right? And yeah. There was a guy who won the Tour de France, I don't know how many times, king of the hill, bicycle rider, athlete. Everybody used to wear the yellow armbands for his foundation, and all of a sudden he gets caught doping. Now obviously it's wrong, and he controlled his what he put in his body, and I'm not advocating for that at all. What I am advocating for is how he responded to getting caught. And he got caught, and if you read the left side of this graphic, being a victim, he didn't seek reality around the fact that he got caught. He actually put up a big fight about it. And
oh yeah,
he blamed the doping agency, the cycling industry. He blamed his teammates publicly and ultimately made a lot of personal excuses. And what you watched, if you followed his story at that time, is you watched a man's life just completely crumble and fall apart and go into a downward spiral, right? Like he lost his foundation, he lost all the endorsements, he lost all this stuff. And then there's a lady named Oprah Winfrey, Rick, that brought him on TV, put him on an interview. And all I can surmise is she challenged him to become an accountable person. And she said, you're going to have to seek reality and own this. If you want to move your life forward, you got to own this. And through an awkward interview, I remember watching it very vividly. It was awkward, but he acknowledged that he did it. He acknowledged he owned it. And the story is his story to still be written, of course. But he moved his life onto a path of getting on with it. And he didn't hang out in this victim position where his life was just constantly spiraling out of control, right? Do you remember watching that interview? Do you have any thoughts, comments?
Yeah, I mean, it humbling would be an understatement. But the truth is, in his victim mode, it's not a very magnetic energy behind no. people who blame and deflect and point fingers. And, you know, it may be silly to some, but, you know, that whole when you point a finger, you've got four pointed back at you or three. And there's just some of that. That when people are vulnerable and own their mistakes, it's far easier for people to also forgive because yeah. we see ourselves in them and we see we're all vulnerable to making mistakes and bad judgments in a given moment, especially when you're young. And that's just the human experience.
Yeah. And you know, here, both you and I are in leadership positions inside of the real estate industry, and we get the phone calls when an agent makes a mistake. And I actually had this happen to me early on in my leadership journey, because I would take the phone call from a disgruntled consumer, and I would sit there on the phone going, oh my gosh, I can't believe they did that. I'll have to talk to them. And basically, I was allowing the problem to still exist with my agent, and I didn't personally take any ownership of it. And I realized the problem would just fester with the consumer. So I, in teaching and knowing I needed to think this way, Rick, I early on learned to own the problem. Oh my God, Mr. and Ms. Consumer, I'm so sorry. We made a mistake. I'll take ownership of that. How can we solve this? How can we move this forward? And the energy in that call went from such a negative festering energy to it was painful, but it moved forward, right? And even though I didn't personally make the mistake, as a leader, you have to own the mistake sometimes, right?
Yeah.
It's crazy. Well,
as soon as you take things personally, Brett, you tend to become defensive. And when you become defensive, you start thinking about how you'll respond. And you start to make it becomes an intellectual experience, not an emotional experience. And when people are upset, they bring emotion to the conversation, not typically intellect first. Now, obviously, the facts and the data are buried inside of the emotion, but you're not going to chop away at the intellectual side until you connect with them on a personal level. So by owning that you're part of the problem, even if you didn't cause it, and you're part of a solution chain, I think it's comforting. And people stop talking and they start listening as well. And it becomes a little bit of reciprocity in the conversation around how do we make this right?
Yeah.
And so, yeah, being accountable is a beautiful thing and owning your mistakes is a beautiful thing. And then the secret is not to focus or dwell on it any longer than you have to. All right, we did it. It happened. And now what? Right.
Right. You know, and I think when you say the word accountability, I think a lot of people in their mind think somebody's standing over me with a whip, whipping me, telling me to keep going, go faster, do more, show up. It's almost like that trainer thought process, right? But the reality is nobody can really hold you accountable. They can attempt to hold you accountable, but if you don't be accountable, which is the phrase here, You're giving the energy to allow yourself to be accountable, and it's a choice. And, you know, you text your group of guys every day how many push-ups, squats, and sit-ups you do. They're not really holding you accountable, are they, Rick? It's your choice to be accountable to the group.
That's exactly right. It's just a reminder that, hey, I made a decision. This is important to me. And I want other people to be aware of when I fall short so that I feel more just more aware of the capacity to make up for it. And by the way, it's not about perfection, Brett. It's about progress. Yeah. I missed 3 days this week because I moved from a house and into a four-story townhome. I had 25,000 steps one day and you know, 80 floors, if you could imagine that. I wanted to just lay in a cold ice bath. But I didn't do my push-ups and sit-ups. I still wanted to be held accountable. And I still, that was a commitment. And so the first step in accountability is a commitment and a realization that, hey, these things need to happen for me to be happy, successful, fulfilled. And if you can figure out what those things are, you know, one reason people avoid accountability is they're not clear on what the commitment is, or they let themselves off the hook from even focusing on the commitment so that they then don't have to stress out about accountability. And then it's Groundhog Day. You're just repeating, hoping something organic miraculously changes something, right?
Yeah.
100%. So how would you address accountability?
Yeah, the same way. I mean, I got to decide, what is it that I need to be accountable around to go live the dream I'm chasing, right? Go live the activity I need to do. If my dream's to go get healthy, what are the activities I need to be accountable around? If my dream's to go make $500,000 in income, what are the activities I need to be accountable around? And then it goes back to all this, right? Like self-mastery. How do I make that fit me, right? How do I time block, or how do I do those things? 80-20 rule. What are the things I need to prioritize and focus on to move me towards that goal or that dream? E to P, how do I be purposeful about my pursuit? Not necessarily just show up with my gifts, but how am I purposeful? Is there a system I can run, or is there a model I should follow, or a piece of technology? Being learning based, is there somebody has lived before me, Rick? I should probably seek wise advice of somebody that's done it before, whether I read it in a book or talk to you or talk to me. Let's get some advice, right? And then, are there some thoughts in my head that I need to work through to get me on my way? Because am I holding myself back with some limited thinking? Do I need to talk through those or get somebody to counsel me through those? And then all through this process is, okay, now let's just go be accountable. Do I need to hire a coach? Do I need to hire a trainer? Do I need to have a peer partner that says, hey, I need you to text me and I'll text you every night at 5 o'clock and I'll tell you what I did. And being accountable is a choice that moves me to those dream goals, desires, passions, right?
Yeah, I think it was Nietzsche that said, you know, it's choice, not chance, determines your destiny. And so what I heard you say is step one would be to visualize what you want categorically or as clearly as you can. Then make a commitment to the visualizations of what you want. And that's a decide moment. And then find role models and systems that enable that trajectory. And then instead of focusing on the outcome, like it's easy to go, hey, I want to be a model, or I want to, you know, physical Adonis best, you know, and do a triathlon. That's an end game goal. And it's hard to wake up tomorrow and go, I'm a triathlete. But it's not hard to wake up tomorrow and go, I'm going to put on sneakers and walk 10,000 steps.
Yeah.
And like, so what activities lead you? And I think the accountability around activities is far, far easier than than being accountable to an outcome, because outcomes are nebulous and sometimes long range and long term. So creating bite-sized pieces that reverse engineer into the role models that you want, and then the visualizations and the decision that's attached to it.
Yep. Rick, this has been fun. One of my favorite series, because I used to teach this for like 8 years, right? But I know this is the secret sauce. This is the thinking part of pursuing a big life, And I appreciate you just co-piloting this with me. And heck, Mojo yeah. Monday, stay tuned Mojo for our Monday. Next series starting next Monday, right?
All right. So visualize the best you, commit to it, and put something in your day planner that create an appointment with yourself tomorrow to take that first step.
Love it. Rick All Hill, right, brother. Mojo Monday.
Mojo Monday, Brett. See you guys. We love you guys.
Call me, 'cause I don't wait.